Hey crew, I've got the key to this McLaren 720S Spider. We are going to take it for a drive, but first let's check it out what looks on the inside and outside. This one is painted in amaranth red, and while it's not quite as stealth fighter as a black or gunmetal gray, it's also not as in your face as some of the supercar oranges and greens. This is a really rich color with metallic flake on the paint surface. We have some carbon fiber accessories like here for the vents, black gloss front splitter, the aero sculpted eye socket with the daytime running light here above LED headlights, sending cool air to the heat exchangers. There are ducts down here, channeling cool air around the front brakes and tires. We've got gunmetal wheels, 19 inch front, 20s in the rear. They're wrapped in Pirelli P0 tires, 245 section front, 305 in the rear, just ahead of carbon ceramic brakes as standard. 720S badge, more carbon fiber accessories for the door mirrors, and this huge aero channel is incredible. Just flowing under the floating buttresses. Stepping back to look at the profile. Just so windswept, the low to high movement of the lines. At the back, when the adjustable rear wing is not deployed, there's just like this pinch design down to the LED taillights, which are not on right now, and the meshing. Two center exit exhaust ports rise up and you see the cowling just to the left and right of the driver and passenger. And then down low, this prominent diffuser in black gloss, peek in at the powertrain components. This car just looks like a force of nature. It's so transparent about what it can do. I love it. Let's check out that interior. To open up, you reach your hand inside and feel for a pad that you press on and gently lift up the dihedral or butterfly or supercar style doors. And while we're looking under them, these buttons here raise or lower the tonneau cover. So if you have the roof up, there's actually some shallow storage space under there. The storage in the supercar is insane. You have your huge front trunk, which was so big I was able to fit my 6 foot self in there. And then yes, when the roof is up, you've got some storage space there. This other button you don't want to have to hit. That's if you need a tow. Your window switches are surrounded in carbon fiber. That's an option. This is your door pull. We have the optional Bowers & Wilkins 12 speaker sound system in this vehicle. Like all supercars, it's got lots of options, including all of the red accents, the red seat belts, the contrast stitching. This Alcantara and leather mixture here looks really nice. These seats are optionally power adjustable and heated. Getting inside is pretty easy for a supercar, especially with the roof off. You just kind of sit your butt on the sill and then slide over from there. The steering wheel is wrapped in leather. It's just the perfect thickness. You got a flat bottom, all this carbon fiber accessory. These carbon fiber paddles are an option as well. You get a digital instrument cluster that changes somewhat as you go through the drive modes, and you can also tilt it forward. It does this in sport or track mode as well, to just show you the gear selection, your tachometer, and speed. There's a portrait style touchscreen infotainment that's serviceable. It's sometimes laggy and it doesn't have Apple CarPlay or Android Auto. Also, if you're wearing polarized sunglasses, you have to tilt your head to the side to actually be able to see it. To the left is a control panel. You have to hit the active button to change any of these settings. Up top is for the handling settings, and down low is for the powertrain. You also have your arrow button right here to raise or lower the spoiler. Start, stop button, all these switches here are for drive, neutral, and reverse. Your launch control system. This switch will raise or lower the back glass. You get a pass through to hear the engine better. And then this one is for the roof. And let's show you that process. I'll pull the door down. And let's lift up the top. This is an 11 second process and can be done at speeds up to 31 miles per hour. That's really quick, and I love this. With a hardtop convertible, you don't expect much from the top, but look, it's a glass piece and you can make it transparent or tinted, just whenever you want. That is so cool. This whole cabin is amazing. It looks expensive. It looks stylized. Even with the roof up, I've got headroom. Seriously, the only thing in here that doesn't look amazing is the rearview mirror. Looks like they pulled that off a Fiat 500. And on that bombshell, let's take it for a drive. All right, let's fire it up. Our digital gauge cluster rises to welcome. And that was a loud startup, don't get me wrong, but if the car has actually been sitting overnight, the cold start is thunderous. I've been driving the car a while this morning, so it wasn't quite as loud. It's so loud, not as loud as the Huracan's V10. That's still just like unbelievable. But this is loud enough that it would make you think twice about leaving too early in the morning to disturb your neighbors, or at least you'd need to send around a bulletin the night before warning them. Turn off these parking sensors here. Or not. Or I'm not going to turn them off. Or I'll just back up far enough. We have as an option on this vehicle a 360-degree surround view camera system. Very useful when you're driving a car this expensive. You don't want to scrape any wheels. And then your backup camera is pretty wide angle. It takes up the whole gauge cluster. The resolution's good. Good enough for you to be able to see an obstacle. And then we'll ease on out of here. And after you back out in reverse by, of course, pulling on the tap, you can pull or press this down to drive or just pull a paddle. We're beginning with the top down. And all windows up, including that back glass piece. Powertrain in the 720S Spyder. It's a peach. 4-liter twin turbocharged V8. It makes 710 horsepower and 568 pound-feet of torque. That's connected to a 7-speed dual clutch automatic gearbox, sending power to just the rear wheels. Now the start-stop system works just fine, but upon startup, if you're in a hurry, like you start the car and you're like, oh, the light's green, I gotta go, be prepared because it takes a second for the car to actually shift into gear. And so as I'll demonstrate here, light's green, starts on the moment you take your foot off the brake, but if you are like urgently needing to get on the throttle, so you're like a quarter throttle tip in, the shift into gear happens and then it like lurches you forward. So the turn off and turn on is fine, but the transition to the gear at low speeds can get frustrating. You'll just find yourself turning that off. Thankfully, when you hit that button, it will stay off even when you start the car your next time. When you're not using all 710 horsepower, when you're in the comfort settings, which, by the way, they're just on by default, but when you hit the active panel here, that assures that whatever settings you have for the up high handling and down low powertrain are in play. So we've got comfort for handling and comfort for powertrain. And with the top down, we're just enjoying the cruise. And at 55 miles per hour, you get that wind buffeting right there at the top of your head, but kind of down here at chin level, there's not a lot of it. And you can always play with the window heights to kind of mitigate some of that turbulent noise. That's convertible weather right there. Add to that some truly incredible ride quality from these adaptive dampers. And the 720 Spyder just becomes a joyous top-down cruiser that at any moment can rip your face off with performance. That moment isn't right now, though. Right now, we're going to see about that turning radius test. Crank the wheel. Not fantastic. You may need to 2 or 3-point turn
certain things. How about the horn? All important. Speed slower. Yeah. Yeah, that's a horn. It's a mighty fine horn. Gosh, this ride quality is so good. For a supercar, it's unbelievably smooth. It just meters out all the bumps and bruises in the road. But then you get bored of that and you want to go to sport at least in the powertrain. And that makes the digital gauge cluster tilt back forward, so you're just looking at the speed, your gear position, tachometer, and speed. The exhaust gets a little louder. You can really hear those turbos. The whistle. Sucking in all that air. And as we head into track powertrain mode and sport handling, we need to see about how quick this car gets to 60. To get a proper readout, I have my race box set up here, and I'm then going to hit the launch button just behind my gear selections. Foot hard on the brake, boost building, boost ready. Here it goes. seconds. Okay. Sure, whatever you say, race box. Might as well have been light speed. So the reason that wasn't as quick as the quoted 2.8 seconds from McLaren. One, the tires were not warm. Yes, I drove it a bit this morning, but I didn't drive it the way you need to warm up the tires, and then I sat in a parking lot letting them cool off. We also were on a bit of an uphill gradient there. Still, half a second off of the quoted ideal conditions of 2.8 seconds is not bad for a rear drive supercar. All that power to just the rear wheels, yet the moment that the track control can kind of feed out the power here to this tire, power to this tire, and then just get you out of that hole, it's an assault the way it claws forward, rips forward. And there's just zero hesitation from the twin turbo setup. One turbo, hey, Archon, Spider, look at you. That is a great soundtrack, right? We'll get on that, more on that in a second. But there's always this gap fill of torque. No hesitation, no delay. And it's not just the straight line performance. The corner carving brilliance of this car. There's just this effortless balance as it negotiates every curve so fluidly. It's so planted. And this 7-speed is a marvel. We've been having it in auto mode or auto/manual mode, but we want to lock it into manual, so you hit this button here under the powertrain configurations. And that cues up my control. I ran out of air. The turbos didn't, but I ran out of air. It is so vicious in the way it attacks the road. And the pop, you hear that? Ooh. Just... Magnificence. This gearbox is... engage the next gear right away. Oh, the pop on the downshift. And continue the tornado of thrust forward. And if at any point in time you tire of the roof being off, you can raise it quickly by pulling back, not pressing forward, pulling back on this tab right here at speeds below 31 miles per hour, and 11 seconds later, you're done. You're a hardtop now. Seriously, it's just that quiet. The conversion process is just that easy. And this glass roof is just that cool. Before we reach a verdict on the 720S Spider, we need to sample its, well, one of its party pieces, variable drift control. To do that, I'm going to go into track mode for everything, and then I'm going to hit the ESC button once to put us into ESC dynamic mode. That then allows us to use variable drift control to adjust how much slip we want from our slide. How cool is that? Well, we're going to find out. So, take over some manual control. Head into this corner. See how good these carbon ceramics are. Oh yeah. And then dive in. And carry a little too speed, too much. And then it just lets you. Honestly, my takeaway from that was not, hey, variable drift control is cool, which it is. It was actually that the times I was expecting the car to just give up the grip, it refused to do so. The downforce generated by that wing and all the aerodynamics built into the car, and just the mechanical grip available to you, means that just your anticipation for the limits of the car are just thrown out the window. I was like, oh, here, it's going to let up here. Nope, didn't let up there. Here? Nope, not there. You really have to misbehave to actually make the back end come around. But then if you want to force it, you have something that's going to keep you from absurd trouble or a very expensive repair with variable drift control. My goodness, this car. Okay, but we'll take it out of track stuff. Let's go back to comfort. Five variable drift control. Hello, full digital gauge cluster. To speak for a moment about cruising on the highway, I mentioned that it gets very quiet with the top up, and truly, it's just as quiet as a hard top. I've got a little bit of wind noise coming just behind my head back here. There's a faint hum of road noise. But it's so good. It's so livable. The duality of this car, it blows my mind that it's this comfortable, this easy to drive, and then can just do what we experience right there. How does it stack up against other convertible supercars? The starting figure for the McLaren 720S Spider is $315,000. This one is tested $377,000. That stacks up as the most expensive when comparing it to both the Ferrari F8 Spider and the Lamborghini Huracan Evo Spider. The Huracan Evo Spider is the cheapest of the set at $287,000. It also makes the least power at 640 horsepower. It's the slowest to 60 at 3.1 seconds. Not 6, my goodness. 3.1 seconds, and the top speed is the lowest, even with the top up, at 202 miles per hour. It also gets pretty bad fuel coming in, I think 16 combined if you cheat, and it's the heaviest of the set too, at 3,400 pounds. The Ferrari F8 Spider is, I think, the closest match for this car. I mean, yes, in neither the Ferrari or the McLaren are you getting that incredible Huracan, naturally aspirated V10 soundtrack, but the Ferrari has the same 710 horsepower for its $302,500 starting figure, a relative bargain compared to the 720S's 315, and it gets to 60 just as quick, 2.8 seconds. The top speed is 1 mile per hour slower at 211 miles per hour, and the fuel economy is worse than this. This car gets incredibly good fuel economy. It's 15 city, but 22 highway and 18 combined. shockingly good. The Ferrari is also maybe 50 pounds heavier than this. This is like a 3,250-pound car. That's like a 3,300-pound car. Both the Ferrari and the McLaren have this just richness of feedback for all the senses. Most especially as I'm remembering it, the Ferrari's steering is just, it's so communicative, it's so precise, and the McLaren gives us that too. The gearbox in the Ferrari, rapid shifts just like this. The Ferrari and this are such even match. So it comes down to kind of aesthetics, whereas the Ferrari is smoother, but it has like this pompness to the exterior, where the McLaren is a little more dynamic in the way it looks. The interior maybe not as comely as the Ferrari, but it's this kind of covert supercar vibe relative to that Ferrari. And so with them being so closely matched, I can't say objectively one car is better than the other. It really just comes down to your personal preference. Which do you think looks better? And I mean, today I'm thinking McLaren 720S Spider. I like that sort of subdued attitude. Then again, I mean, if someone was just come in the night and steal one car and replace it with another, I would just sort of shrug my shoulders and we'll just drive the heck out of either one of them. Guys, I hope you've enjoyed this POV drive review of the McLaren 720S Spider. If you did, please like, comment, and share the video. Subscribe to the channel, hit that bell to get notified. And even in comfort, we're going for it. I'll see you next time.